So the first video that I did was all about the syllabus and what to expect in this class. The second video is a little bit of background that we covered on the first day. So when we talk about operating systems, we really have to have a fairly good understanding of what's going on inside the computer. So it's important to know that at the bottom level of the memory hierarchy, we have the secondary storage. That can be things like a hard disk or a solid state drive. Typically, your hard disk has moving parts. It typically has a mean time to failure that is random. So it is not going to run for exactly 1,400 hours and then stop working. But the average time that it takes for it to stop working is that mean time to failure. That means that the more hard drives you put in a room, the faster you will have one of them break. That's because you take that mean time to failure and you divide it by the number of hard drives in the room. The other kind is this solid state drive, which shares some technology with the USB flash drives that we use to transfer our files. So a solid state drive is faster than a hard disk, but it also has a downside. There's a fixed number of writes that a solid state drive is able to handle, and then it will stop working. However, both the solid state drive and the hard disk, all secondary storage, in fact, is persistent. So when power stops being transmitted to the hard disk and the solid state drive, they retain their information for later. That is not the case with the next layer of the memory hierarchy, which is memory, also known as RAM, which is random access memory. Random access memory is made typically with one transistor and one capacitor for every bit that you are storing in memory. Now, that means that when power is no longer transmitted to memory, all of the power that was in those capacitors goes away, effectively resetting memory to all zeros. Above the memory, there are multiple layers of cache. So there might be a last layer of cache that is shared by all of the cores that exist inside of the processor. There is definitely a level 2 cache, which each individual core has access to. So each core gets its own level 2 cache. Each core also gets its own level 1 cache, which is split between instructions and data. So the way that this ends up working, the higher the level of cache, the smaller it is and the faster it is to access. And then on top of that level 1 data and instruction cache, we have the CPU itself. Each individual core has its own registers, which are the smallest unit of information storage that we have access to. In operating systems, we are focused on the CPU, we are focused on memory, and we are focused on secondary storage. We don't worry too much about the cache in systems too, because all of that cache is in hardware specifically. And what I mean by that is that it is entirely hardware controlled. The operating system has no control over what happens to be in cache at any given point in time. So we don't worry too much about that. But it is important to know that the CPU itself is only as utilized as the programs that are currently running on it. Now, a CPU on its own is a central processing unit. A central processing unit can have multiple cores on it. What I mean by that is that each individual core has an arithmetic and logic unit. It has its own registers, and it has a program counter, which keeps track of which instruction is currently executing. So that translates to a single stream of instructions being able to compute on a single core at any given point in time. In the next video, we'll talk a little bit more about hyperthreading, which is when we have two program counters and it's able to keep track of two streams of instructions at the same time, but it can still only execute one instruction at a time.